2018 year. Your summer, if you want to administer the oath of office to myself and Mr. Hubert.
Do you solemnly swear that you will support the Constitution of the State of Ohio and the Constitution of the United States, and that you will faithfully perform and discharge your duties as members of the Board of Education of the Salina City School District in Mercer County, Ohio?
Kind of anticlimactic, no Bibles, no. Okay, call the roll, please.
Mr. Gilmore.
Here.
Mr. Sell.
Here.
Mrs. Voorhees.
Here.
Mr. Huber.
Here.
Mr. Shellbutter.
Here.
Okay, I'll open the floor for nominations for president at this time.
I'll make a motion for Mr. Gilmore.
Do we have a second?
I'll second it.
Okay, Mr. Huber, any further nominations? Mr. Sumner, if you'd call the roll, please.
Mr. Huber?
Aye.
Mr. Shellbutter?
Yes.
Mrs. Voorhees?
Yes.
Mr. Sell?
Yes.
Mr. Gilmore?
Aye. Okay, well now, I think we'll administer both those oaths of office at the same time, so we'll move right on to opening the floor to nominations for vice president.
I would like to nominate Mr. Sell.
I'll second that.
Any further nominations? Okay, call the roll, please.
Mr. Shellbutter.
Yes.
Mr. Huber.
Yes.
Mrs. Voorhees.
Yes.
Mr. Gilmore.
Aye.
Mr. Sell.
Yes.
Do you solemnly swear that you will support the Constitution of the State of Ohio and the Constitution of the United States, and that you will faithfully perform and discharge your duties as President and Vice President of the Board of Education of the Salina City School District in Mercer County, Ohio?
Motion to set the agenda for the remainder of the organizational meeting.
So moved.
I'll second.
Call the roll, please.
Mr. Sell?
Yes.
Mr. Shellbutter?
Yes.
Mr. Huber?
Yes.
Mrs. Voorhees?
Yes.
Mr. Gilmore?
Aye. Okay, we now have several appointments. Carl, you would be the one without a current appointment.
I would like to jump in on the tax abatement liaison if I could.
Okay, that's fine. Anybody else want to move from where they were previously? If not, then I'll just swap and take head start. Barb, you were student.
I was community.
Oh, community.
Kurt was student.
Kurt was student. Yep, everything stayed the same.
Under letter A, we have the establishment of the board meeting times and dates for 2018. Of course, we have the first meeting for this evening, followed by February 12th, March 19th, April 16th, May 21st, June 18th, July 16th, August 13th, September 17th, October 15th, November 19th, December 17th. You will see those are all the third Mondays of the month, except for tonight, because of Martin Luther King is the third Monday, February 12th and not the 19th because of President's Day, and August 13th also is the second Monday. That way we can do any last hires prior to the school year actually getting underway. The summer meetings again, June, July, and August, will be at the educational complex. All meetings starting at 6 o'clock.
Anyone have any conflicts with any of those days or times?
I might have one with July 16th. I think I can work around.
Okay. Well, then obviously if we get there and we want to change it.
Yes. Okay. All right. Thank you.
Under letter B, we're asking to authorize the treasurer to pay all bills as they are presented to him, provided those funds are available in the appropriated accounts approved by the Board of Education. Number two, invest interim and or inactive funds at the most productive interest rates whenever funds are available. Number three, request advances on local taxes due to the school district from the county auditor when funds are available, along with the president of the Board of Education. Under letter C, resolution to establish a board service fund for the sign of Board of Education in the amount of $7,500. That is the maximum allowable amount. Under letter D, approve the following organizational resolutions. The appointment of Dr. Ken Schmiesing and Tom Summer as purchasing agents for the school district during calendar year 2018. Number two, authorize the superintendent to employ such temporary personnel as needed for emergency situations. Personnel will be presented for approval by the board at the next meeting and or special meeting. Number three, authorize the treasurer and the superintendent to attend professional meetings outside the school district for the benefit of Salina City School District. Number four, authorize the memberships in the following organizations: Ohio Association for the School Business Officials, Buckeye Association for School Administrators, Ohio School Boards Association, the American Association for School Administrators, American Vocational Association, Ohio Vocational Association, Ohio Trade and Industrial Education Association, Vocational Supervisors Association, Salina Mercer County Chamber of Commerce, Grand Lake Safety Council, Northwest Ohio Educational Research Council. Number five, authorize the payment of out-of-pocket expenses for the TriStar Advisory Council members representing Salina City Schools.
Anyone have any questions on any of those items?
Number five, is that the same language we had a year ago? Yeah,
it should be.
The out-of-pocket expenses, we did that same. Okay.
Yes.
Anything else? Any items to be removed from the consensus agenda?
I have a question for Mr. Summer regarding that. I'm going to be, I think, compensated for paying for go to the Ohio School Board Association. Should that be removed? Do I need it?
No, because it's a reimbursement.
Okay, gotcha.
But that's later on. That's not.
That's right. That's right.
Okay, call the roll on the consensus agenda, please.
Mr. Huber.
Yes.
Mr. Shelbart.
Yes.
Mrs. Voorhees.
Yes.
I'll say.
Mr. Sell.
Yes.
Mr. Gilmore.
Aye.
Under letter H, the board declaration of insurance coverage, a board member is entitled to purchase and pay 100% of the premium for health and dental insurance. Okay. Mr. Gilmore.
No and no.
Mr. Huber?
No, no.
Phil's.
Mr. Sell?
Phil's.
No, no.
Mr. Shellharder?
No, no.
Mrs. Voorhees?
No, to both.
Thank you.
This concludes the organizational meeting. We will therefore go right into calling to order the regular meeting for tonight. Start over with roll call, please, Mr. Summer.
Mr. Gilmore?
Here.
Mr. Sell?
Here.
Yeah.
Mrs. Voorhees?
Here.
Mr. Huber?
Here.
Mr. Shellharder?
Here.
Do I have a motion to set the agenda?
Sorry.
And call the roll, please.
Mrs. Voorhees?
Yes.
Mr. Sell?
Yes.
Mr. Huber?
Yes.
Mr. Shellharder?
Yes.
Mr. Gilmore?
Aye. Reception of the public. Leave, we are about to be enthralled and entertained by the one and only Ann Esselstein.
Actually, as any good supervisor does, they bring the crew to do all the entertaining. So, I'm not even going to step up there tonight because I have brought three outstanding Salem Middle School staff to enlighten you about a couple things that go on at the middle school. The first is our Pride program. The Pride program is an after-school program that we hold every day for an hour. And Pride stands for Personal Responsibility in Daily Efforts. And our goal is, with many of our students, enhancing responsibility. So, I'm going to turn that over to Mr. Dwyer, who is the program guru.
Oh, I, yeah.
And he's going to just share some things. And then I'll bring up Mrs. Martin and Mr. Smith here in a moment for, if you want to say it there with them. For the onboarders, for the onboarders.
What's that? Thank you. So, Ann pretty much just said what I was going to say. It's an after-school program. Unfortunately, the program has received some bad rap from the students themselves. They think that it's more of a punishment, but really, we're trying to push them into being responsible, advocating for themselves, and making sure that they're on top of their game. And every day they pick up a paper, they check in with their teachers, they then have to, at the end of the day, check out with me if they receive red slips or don't receive signatures. As part of the program, they're expected to stay that hour after school. And so Pride is sort of combined with Study Tables, our after school program. So we've tried to put a positive spin on it a little bit more this year by putting some points to go along with it. So you get points for signatures, you get points for getting signatures from your parents, you get points for attending school, and these points then we're going to use to, we have used for rewards, accolades. We've put some posts on Facebook to honor some students, to acknowledge their accomplishments. We've at Christmas time we did a big thing where we set challenges. The challenge was to write a goal every day for a week, and then they got put in for a yard of Snickers and a yard of M&Ms and big candy cane and $25 gift cards to Walmart. And so we've tried to up the incentives, and I think the biggest thing for me is one of my big projects, I'm the computer tech teacher, and one of my big projects is at the end of the quarter they have tips to surviving the middle school, and I create these videos and I send them to the sixth graders at IC and the intermediate school. And one of my students actually said that the Pride program was a good thing, and I thought, hey, we're making some headway here. So that was the positive spin that I got from the Pride program. Any questions?
You know, how does a kid get a teacher signature by like doing their homework?
So at the end of every period, they are to write down the assignment for the day, and then they are to go to their teacher, and their teacher will sign the Pride paper for them.
How does a student find him or herself enrolled in the Pride?
There are multiple ways.
Some are parent requested, some are student requested, and in our building, if you achieve 3 detentions in a 9 weeks, you get placed on the program.
There's a punitive part. There's a label.
Yes. So, yes, yes, that's where,
it's not
that's where.
At that
right, it's not mandatory. So the mandatory
it's
part.
Table part.
Right, so you're put on the program, and basically that just means you have to make sure that you're writing down your assignments and your teachers are acknowledging that that is in fact the assignment and making sure that you have the previous night's assignment finished. When you reach 6 detentions, that's when you become mandatory study tables. You have to stay then for an hour after school. So that 3 detentions is sort of your, here's a little warning for you, like we're going to put you on this program to kind of help get you on track, keep you yourself organized, and then until they reach 6. If they have a perfect day, if they have all their assignments, they get all their signatures, they check out with me, I say see ya, they go home.
Can a kid go voluntarily?
Yes.
I've got kids a 3-5, I just want to go because I want to do
yes.
my homework. And,
yes, students have put themselves on the program because they were on it last year as 7th graders and this year as an 8th grader. They're like, that worked for me, I'm going to put myself back on there.
Is there a time period for these detentions? I mean, do you go off the books? Like if I've got 3 detentions in the first week of school, I have to attend the rest of the year?
You are on the program then the remainder of
semester.
That's, I think it's semester. I mean, we've kind of played around with that a little bit too. But you are on the program then for the remainder of the semester.
How many kids go there voluntarily? 10%?
Oh, I think right now I have 78 students on the program and I'm 2 might be.
Is there a stigma to that? Do they see it? Is that why they don't use it as a voluntary program? Do they see it as?
I think they do. I think that's, yeah. Okay. I think they do. And so that's why this year we've tried to add the point system and we've, on morning announcements, we've acknowledged the students who are doing what they're expected to do. And
do you have any like peer teaching in there where a student council kid can come and help this kid that's got 6 detentions or whatever?
We don't have that at this time, and Ann and I were just actually talking about that on Friday, that we wanted to try and do this buddy system, putting some 7th and 8th graders together and making teams, and those teams then can earn some points, and so it'll keep students on top of other students to make sure they're getting their work done. So we're going to kind of, with this being the last week of the 9 weeks, we're going to hopefully start at the beginning of then of next semester. See if we can't get some teamwork going on.
You say you acknowledge students on the morning announcements. What would that entail?
So every morning, Mrs. Esselstein does the morning announcements, and so depending upon, so it might be that for an entire week a student has gotten all signatures, has gotten all high, they get ranked by their teacher in their behavior, their attitude in class, high, middle, low, so they could be acknowledged for having all highs, having all their signatures, not having any red slips, so we just acknowledge those students to the entire building.
Give them a Renaissance Award.
When they
show donuts.
How many of them actively participate in doing their homework with them? Or do some of them just show up to get their time in so that they can go home? I would think.
That's a good question. I would say 95% of them understand the reason they're on the program and follow through with it. And then you have those students who want to buck the system, think they do no wrong, but for the major portion of the students, I think it works, and we've seen it work. The number of 7th grade students going into 8th grade, that number has dwindled. I wish I had those numbers for you, but we don't have near as many 8th graders as we do 7th graders. In 7th grade, they're learning. They're like, okay, I'm on this. And then, like I said, we had an 8th grader this year who said, I want to be back on this program, can I get on? Because it knew it kept him organized.
Good.
We have had high school students request a similar program, so that has been instituted this year. Kim Sutter stays after school. She comes in a period late. stays a period late after school and has students come to study tables at the high school. So that has really helped students at the high school.
What's it called, the private program?
Do you have a particular name for that, Mr. Max?
Study tables.
But it's not mandatory.
Athletes. That's part of the board's athletic directive. So those students.
Was that initiated by the coaches?
Initiated by the athletic council.
Yeah.
If at any point you would be interested in coming around 2:30 or 2:20 to see the checkout process and to see how the students are and set of tables, you're more than welcome to stop on over. Love to have you. And while I'm up there, I'm going to hang on to the mic. I see that number two, I'm on the list there for CEA co-president. So as on behalf of CEA, I'd like to just welcome Mr. Huber to the board.
Thank you. Look
forward to having you.
Yeah.
Thank you.
As many of you know, Mr. Dwenger, the atmosphere is kind of very positive with study tables and such. He does a wonderful job with it. And there's always two staff members that are there to help kids with homework or questions they have. And so it's staff and they keep busy making the rounds to all the kids that put a hand up to say, can you help?
So is that always two teachers then, the staff members?
Not necessarily a teacher. It could be an aide who sticks around and spends an hour after school. It just varies. It's always at least one teacher. I'm now going to bring up Mr. Doug Smith and Mrs. Melinda Martin, two of our science teachers. Melinda is 7th grade and Mr. Smith is 8th grade. And last year was a year of looking over textbooks and doing a textbook adoption for the science department. And our science department decided against a textbook and instead went with this program called Gizmo. So I would expect, go, what is that? What is that really all about? So they're here to introduce and show you a little bit of what we're doing with the Gizmo and why we chose the Gizmo over the textbook.
Do we need to sit out there?
I think just spin maybe.
Started a few years ago when the Ohio Education Department decided to make the testing online. And as a science department, we went to the ODE website and we looked at some of the sample science questions. And we realized as a team that not only did we need to teach the kids the content, the science content, but they also needed the computer skills in order to navigate these new tests online. So we went online ourselves and started looking for resources. And we came across Gizmos, which are online simulations. Online simulations. And they, first and foremost, I guess we want you to realize is what they are not games. They're actual labs. If you click on the Building PNG one there, it's kind of like an entire curriculum into itself. For each one of the simulations, it follows a standard in our Ohio content. You get a teacher resource guide, kind of like a pacing guide. And you also get student exploration sheets, which is what I handed out to you. And then you have the simulation itself. If you take a look at the student exploration sheet that I gave you, it's broken down into different sections. for each one of these simulations, you always start with like a prior knowledge section, something that you can kind of use as a pre-assessment to kind of gauge what your students already know about the topic. Then it leads into a warm-up where you can actually show the students how the simulation itself works. Then you start into the actual activities. So you launch the gizmo. And what's really neat about these gizmos is that they're very interactive and the students have to manipulate the pieces to it. So this one is building Pangea, the supercontinent. And how we used to have to do this lab in class was we used to have to do it with pencil and colored or paper and colored pencils, and we used to have to color all the different pieces of evidence on there, such as fossils and mountains and glaciers. And then we'd have to cut them out, and then hopefully the kids didn't lose them from day one to day two when we had to manipulate them and tape them all together to see how they would fit. With this simulation, underneath, like on activity A, I think the first activity that they do is they just manipulate the different continents and try to put Pangea together. Then the second activity would be introducing the evidence. So you would go to the evidence box and pull up the fossil evidence. So you would click on that, and then using the fossil evidence, you would be able to move the continents around and try to place them together using that evidence, which is kind of cool. And then you would use glaciers and what was the other one? The mountains too. So each activity shows you a different piece of evidence. For each one of these activities too, it asks kids to do those important science skills, like it asks students to make predictions. And then it allows them time to experiment with the gizmo. And then you collect data, and then you have to analyze the data, and then apply it. And so it really is a total package in one program. At the end of every simulation, they even give you a five-question like post-assessment that the students can take. So they would go through this assessment at the end of the lab, and there you go. Go through all of them and then check your answers. And what's really neat about this is the scores go to the teachers. Not only what their final score is, but which ones they got correct and which ones they got incorrect, but also when they submit it, it brings up an explanation for each one of those questions. So they can go back and read what they may have missed for that.
Do they do this individually, Melinda, or are they like pairs or groups?
We do it all different ways. Sometimes we'll start it in class and maybe assign a small section for homework. Sometimes, you know, we do it as lab in class with checkpoints. That's my personal favorite. I kind of even like to use it as a whole class activity oftentimes, because I think they get more out of it when they work together. I don't know what we would do without it, really. For 2 years before we were able to get the subscription, we would make up username and passwords because you could get 30-day free trials. So, you know, and then we would all just jump on it when somebody opened a free trial. It saves money because we don't have to buy materials. It allows kids to be really interactive. Another one, which we could show you, but it's a natural selection one. And this is actually one of the suggested activities with our standards. And in this one, because natural selection takes, you know, hundreds of thousands of years, it's really hard for kids to actually grasp that abstract concept. So in this one, they're actually birds. And in the simulation for this one, they're the birds, and they're light-colored trees with dark-colored moss, and so they're going to go through generations. So go to the next tree, though. Just keep going. And then when the moth pops up, they eat them. They click on them and eat them. And it collects the data for them, and it allows them to see what that natural selection is all about. You know that the survival of the fittest isn't the biggest, the strongest, the fastest. It's the ones that have the best adaptation. So I would go to the Galapagos Islands, but you know, this is kind of like the next best thing that we have.
Yes,
so it's a really great program.
It's what they're doing with their state testing. I mean, they're on their computer. They're manipulating. They're answering questions from data. It's right in line with what we're trying to pass at the end of the year. So it goes very well with, you know, working on those skills of being on their computer and having to follow directions and move things around. And we're real happy with that. I think it's helped.
Are they doing this one in that book?
Yeah. See, we're really fortunate. We're a one-to-one building. They have their own Chromebooks, so you know, we don't have to sign up for labs or, you know, the computer labs or anything. We can pull them up whenever we want to use them. Another really great thing is it's not just for science, it's for math. And since our building has a subscription to it, our math department has access to all the math ones. And the PD is really good. They actually offer 4 sessions. We've done 2 of the 4 during our day-long professional development, so they'll be coming back 2 more times, and they just kind of expand and show us more things that we can do with these.
And they're adding new ones every few weeks, so it's, you know, when you buy a textbook, you're kind of stuck there for a while, but they're adding new ones, you know, weekly or monthly, and it's always nice to check those out.
So is this the future of learning?
That's hard to answer. I mean, it may be, but you know, we still use our old textbook, and then we, you know, we supplement activities from here, and still some of our old activities also. But the kids seem to enjoy it because it's hands on, and you know, we feel like they're getting, you know, prepared for the end of the year testing.
So you said they had more, though, you just knew more activities.
Yeah, they're adding new gizmos to
their bank.
Yeah, I mean, you can search, you know, by grade level, you can search by topic. There's, you know, they just have numerous gizmos right now. I can pull that up for you, but if you're interested in finding one, you just click here. And by grade. Eighth grade, Earth, let's say we're working on, you know, space, and we can pull up all kinds of, you know, there's eclipses and tides and phases of moon.
And we probably average throughout the course of the year maybe one of these a week, maybe not quite that much, because really, I mean, nothing can really take the place of a hands-on lab. But what we're realizing is like, no longer do you have to collect data and make graphs by hand, because there's all kinds of simulations out there. But what kids have to learn to do is they have to learn to manipulate and use the technology and also be able to interpret what they're collecting. And that's where this really comes in handy.
So you still incorporate this program into the hands-on labs with?
Yeah, we still do the hands-on labs too. So we don't just strictly do this.
Why just math and science? You know, are they going to branch out to English and social studies and language?
I don't know.
Do the kids have access at home?
Yes. They get a class code, so they sign up for our class, and so they have access to it. We're real careful because we realize not every kid has Wi-Fi at home. You know, that if we do assign any of it for homework, it's small enough chunk that you do during flex AA or stay for the study tables. And that's something that I don't kids not on the Pride program stay for study tables. Anybody can stay. And we have kids all the time that just need to finish up their homework that aren't on the Pride program and they aren't mandatory study tables that stay after school to take advantage of that.
Is that part of the numbers that Eric was quoting earlier when he said like 78 or 80 or whatever? Would that include those kids?
No, that's just
Pride. No, those are just the kids on the Pride. But we have other kids besides kids on the Pride program that stay.
I bet there are 15 to 20 that stay every day that are not required to stay.
So I just want to kind of, I was going to, didn't want to interrupt earlier, but because I worked in the Pride program too, I want to make sure that you guys realize that. Any question, any other question? Actually, we have the subscription for 5th all the way through 12th grade. So they use it in the intermediate building. They also use it here at high school, too. And that's kind of neat. We just share. Like, I'll send Tim Wilgus a list for life science. These are the gizmos we used in life science here at the 7th and 8th grade building. That way she knows, you know, which ones we've done.
Part of the value of our professional development day is to have high school, intermediate, middle school teachers all together so they can share the information and talk about what each other's doing.
Yeah, it's good stuff.
And the majority of our kids now are just visual learners. And so they can put stuff like this in front of them and they can see it. You know?
Yeah, it does. And it goes much faster. It really does. It just goes, you know, there's just something about flicking it versus, you know, putting a little sample of pH paper and, you know, a little bit of tomato juice on it. It's hard to explain because I'm old. You know, I'm old school. Give me the pH paper any day. But I'm realizing very quickly that that's not how our kids today think. And this is definitely one of those directions.
Thank you. Just a couple other quick plugs here. Middle School Musical is coming Friday the 19th of January, 20th and 21st that weekend. We're doing Madagascar Junior. The kids have been working so diligently along with Mrs. Sheila Gudorf and Mr. John Gudorf. I'm sure Mr. Keith Gudorf's got the set ready to go. And I've talked to several of them recently and I'm like, we're there. We've been running all through now. We've got a couple things we're cleaning up and they'll be good to go. And then, you know, you get to second semester after next week, and we will be pre-registering our eighth graders for high school on the 26th. And then on Tuesday, January the 3rd, you can do the high school 101 over here at the high school where Mr. Metz has the eighth graders come in with their parents to get the lay of the land. And then Fridays, February 2nd, we register for high school for the eighth graders.
Here. The high school 101, do you feel you have like student council kids there or a limited amount of the one?
Give them tour guides, basically. Yep. So, anyhow, that's what's going on in the middle school. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
The middle school was recognized again this year, 2 years in a row, Momentum Award winners. So, it's talking about the student growth measures from 1 year to the next. So up there, top 10% in the state of Ohio. So again, we'll be getting a banner out for the middle school, but certainly a thing like Gizmo here, the Gizmos are talking about using that, getting that immediate feedback. The state assessments have gone to online. So instead of getting results back in approximately 3 months, now we get the results back in approximately 2 months. But again, with that length of time to try to help students getting information back almost immediately with a feature like a gizmo certainly is much more beneficial than what a state assessment provides information to us. Asked a question if this is the way of the future. I still believe there's no way you'll ever replace a classroom teacher. That's the biggest piece, I think, for a successful education for our students.
Okay, moving on. Mr. Dwenger, anything further regarding CDA?
Yes, sir.
Anyone
We do have some chocolates in front of each of the board members to try to help recognize them. They also have all received certificates this evening. It is board member recognition, school board recognition month, so certainly want to do a shout out to the board members, certainly for the amount of pay that you received in your job. It certainly doesn't equate to the amount of time, effort, and everything that you put into your positions to help the school district, help the kids and the teachers and the Celina City School District to move in a positive direction. So certainly thank you.
Okay, moving on, I'll entertain a motion to approve the consensus agenda.
So moved.
Second.
By Mr. Sell, seconded by Mrs. Voorhees. Treasurer's report.
Okay, the first item I have is I'm asking you to approve the minutes of December 18, 2017 meeting. Second item, approve the December financial report showing approximately $2.23 million in revenues and $3.68 million in expenditures. Approve the investment control report as of December 31st, 2017 with an ending balance of $29,864,259.35. Also asking you to approve the December 2017 SM2 report. Asking you to approve the December 2017 checks that were written for $3.392 million. Also asking you to authorize the amounts and rates as determined by the Budget Commission, authorizing the necessary tax levies and certifying them to the county auditor. There's one in there for the Celina City School District and then one for the TriStar Fund debt. We do have one additional activity budget in Steve Stewart's classroom to approve. And actually, is National Honor Society, I think we have to wait on that, or is that, I don't remember if National Honor Society got out there or not.
It was in there.
Okay. There's two of them out there. I hadn't seen enough. And then acceptance of a donation from All Star Driving. It's three $100 gift certificates to aid some disadvantaged students.
Anyone have any questions for Mr. Summer?
I've got a couple, Mr. Summer. Attachment two, permanent improvement, I think it's like line item 003, balance is $509K. Does that sound correct? Let's see if I can find it.
The PI fund?
Yes.
Yeah, the actual cash balance is $700,000 basically, and there's outstanding encumbrances of about $190,000. So the unencumbered balance available is the $500,000.
About $500,000, gotcha. Okay. And let's see, also, you explained what the Rotary Fund, Rotary Special Services were. It's a balance of, I think, $48K, and that was Fund 011. But refresh my memory, what is that?
I believe that's the... I can get back to you on that.
Okay. And then just a couple more brief. I had like Fund 532, 533, 536, 573 straight zeros and wondered why they were included unless there was a name or a fund name so they could figure out what was had been in there.
Again, this is a report that's generated from NOACSC at month end. The 532, I know, was the stimulus money back in 2009 and 2011.
And then other than under expenditures, other than salaries and fringe benefits for staff, purchase services, $6.6 million's got to be right there, correct? And I wondered if that's comparable to what it was a year ago.
I would say it's very close. A lot of that's going to be, that's your utilities, that's your cost to the UNC, which is big. But,
that was my next question. Of that $6.6 million, do you know how much of that percentage-wise or dollar amount is ESC money?
Off the top of my head, no, I do not.
And I also had written down, as I think attachment 4 or 5, total revenue 31.1 and total expenses 32.4. And you were at 29.8 on total revenue?
Or no, 29.8 is a total overall fund balance, or balance that we have on our books.
Okay, final question, sorry. Yeah. The levy, what we're thinking about that one, the, under the December check, December 6th, check number 75519, there was $444,000 check for Peterson Construction. I just wondered what project that was.
That's the trash truck.
Okay, I didn't know it was Peterson that got that contract.
Well, Peterson is our construction manager at risk. So, Bruce Building did the work out there, but it's all flowing through Peterson.
Gotcha. Is that a state requirement?
That was the plan we signed up for. Yeah, construction manager, you can have a construction manager, you can completely cowboy it on your own, or you can have some kind of hybrid, and then that was what we tried to have chosen. Yeah.
Okay, any other questions for Mr. Sumner? Dr. Schneezing.
Under personnel for the assistant superintendent's report, approved to hire Kathy Chilko. She's completed her 60-day probationary period. Number two, approved to hire Kelly Braun, teacher assistant, also completed her 60-day probation. And number three, approved to hire Rita Bigelow, custodian at the high school. She has completed her 60-day probationary period. Under the superintendent's report for personnel, ask you to approve a change of contract for Sarah Young. She's requesting a deduct day November 22nd. Number two, approve a change of contract for Michelle Miller, kindergarten teacher. Request a half deduct day December 19th. And Curtis Doner, like to have you approve him as a volunteer for the wrestling program for the 17-18 school year.
Donner passed all the...
Yes, he has. He did coach last year, not for Salina City Schools, but he coached her in another school system. Yeah, normally otherwise you would see the pending certifications behind there. Correct. Good question. Under the Head Start, we have a couple of attachments there just because the information was so voluminous. Thank you, Ms. Esser. So we do have the monthly report, policy council handbook. You would see in the attachment the community assessment there. Also, we want to share, we do have the governance training coming up Thursday night, and that is 6 to 7:30 out of CJ Highmarks. So I'd like to invite the board members, if you have not RSVP'd there, to Head Start and Carla Kessler. Please do so.
Any discussion on that? Any items to be removed from the consensus agenda at this time?
Okay,
Mr. Sumner, call the roll, please.
Mr. Sell.
under informational items. Really, we don't need your approval for this, but just as a point of information, TriStar has now a College Credit Plus agreement with Rhode State for the TriStar Career Tech programs. So we wanted to share that information with you.
Explain how that works, Dr. Schmeisen.
Students in TriStar can take classes at Rhode State and receive both high school and college credit.